88.1 FM and WCWP.org. That's Bobby Caldwell and Educated Girl here on WCWP. Right before that, Motley Crue calling Dr. Feelgood. Give the middle sign. Robert Palmer, Bad Case of Loving You. Dr. Doctor. Jackson Brown, Dr. My Eyes. Graham Parker, to Back to School Days. All on WCWP. I'm Dr. Bernie Bernard. That's the last time I'm going to say it. All right, I did the doctor set. That's it. That's enough of that stuff. It took me 5 years, so indulge me a little bit. Okay.
Yay.
All right, we're done. All right. On WCWP, we have someone who has been at the station doing a show and is celebrating his 36th anniversary, Chris MacIntosh. Hey.
Next weekend.
That's right. That's right. Rock and soul gospel, which has kind of changed a bit over the years, hasn't it?
Yeah. When Bill Moser first brought me on, the show was primarily, for lack of a better term, a Christian rock show. And over the years, what it's developed into is just a really eclectic blend of music by artists who hold to that worldview. Like, I'm at the point now, I don't even believe or like Christian music.
Yeah, I had a friend who worked in the industry for a long time. She said, Christian rock is neither.
Yeah, exactly. And what it is 5 years behind whatever is current.
Yeah, and they don't pay their artists very well, too. I mean, some of it is, not to really trash it too much, but it tends to be a little exploitive of the artists, and that's why I'm kind of not thrilled about that whole industry thing. I mean, just put out some music and go tour and be, you know, somebody who's upfront about your faith and don't go nuts with it.
Like last night, I went over to the Union County Performing Arts Center in Rahway. Mm-hmm. Saw a band called Glass Hammer.
I love them. You play them a lot
on
your show.
Absolutely. Right. We're going to be debuting their new album, Untold Tales, next Sunday evening.
Oh, great.
It's really, really good stuff.
Yeah, they are excellent. And you and I are big fans of progressive rock, so they're proggers all the way, as is Bobby G, who's here in the studio, and Mike Chimeri is here with his camera, videoing us for the archives for Homecoming 2017. So what plans do you have for celebrating?
Well, on Sunday evening, from 5:30 until probably 6:30. The show is on from 5 to 9. So I'll do an opening set for a half hour, and then we have a band from Suffolk called Sils Maria coming in to do a live set right here. And then the last hour or so of the program will be debuting Untold Tales by Glass Hammer.
Nice.
Some pizza up here.
Great way to celebrate 36 years on the air. Quite an accomplishment. Now, I don't know if Casey Kasem or any of those other folks went 36 years. You are the original host and have been for 36 years. Right. Do you have the longest running rock show in the country, in the world, in the universe?
According to Ron Alexenberg, Rock and Soul Gospel is now the world's oldest rock radio show.
Wow.
And
excellent.
I can say that. And that and 275 will get me on the subway in the city.
Oh, but that's an accomplishment. You're part of history, man.
The bragging really rights are wonderful.
Absolutely. And you have every right to do it. Good for you. Yeah. Well, good luck. So you're on this coming Sunday from...
For Homecoming, I'm on Sunday night from 6 until 8.
Okay.
And then the regular program is Friday nights from 9 to 11. And Sunday evenings from 5 to 9.
Okay, so next Sunday evening is the one where you're pulling out all the stops, right?
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're going to do like an extended thing and count Friday night, too.
Well, that's okay. You could do that. You deserve it.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Chris MacIntosh here in WCWP. Continuing with Homecoming Weekend, we have a lot of people who've come from far and wide here to get back in the New York groove on WCWP. FM, WCWP.org. New York is my home. That's Dion and Paul Simon. Interesting combination. Right before that, we heard from Ace Frehley and Back in the New York Groove. I'm Bernie. It's Homecoming Weekend at WCWP. We are going to announce the next class of 2018, the inductees into the WCWP Hall of Fame. But first, we have a special award. This is going to be an annual award. and it is the Chris MacIntosh Award. You are going to get the first one, and then every year hereafter, somebody is going to be given the Chris MacIntosh Memorial Award for... Really? It's basically for people who've worked at the station but didn't go to school the whole time here. So it is to show recognition for your 36 years on the air. And again, you are the initial recipient, and we will be giving out this award in your name every year for other people who have worked at the station but didn't necessarily go to school here.
Okay.
So
very cool.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I blame it all on Bill Moser.
So we blame everything on him.
Can they hear this in there?
Of course they can.
Can you hear this in there? Oh, okay.
All right, good. Well, congratulations, and very well deserved. And 36 years on the air at one station for anybody, that's incredible.
Thank you, Dr. Bernard.
All right, we're done with that. Anyhow, now we are going to go to Ted. Ted David, who's going to tell us about...
Hey, everybody. The Bernie new Bernard. Inductees. You're up from Delray Beach, everybody.
Yes, I am.
Where's your sister?
She's home.
Well, hi, Melissa. She said hello yesterday. I'm trying to. What we have here is the WCWP Hall of Fame announcements. Now I'm proud to say that Bernie is a member of the Hall of Fame.
As are you.
In this very room, what's that?
Check your texts.
Check my texts. And in this very room, Bill Moser is a member of the Hall of Fame. Bobby Guttenberg, Bobby G, is a member of the Hall of Fame. Jeff Kroll is a member of the Hall of Fame. Who isn't a member of the Hall of Fame? Oh, wait. Who else is that? Bruce Leonard is a member of the Hall of Fame. It'd be easier. Who isn't a member of the Hall of Fame? Okay. Yeah, John Cummins isn't. Fudgy isn't. Okay. Wait a minute. I have to switch glasses. This is what happened yesterday with this homecoming. The Alta Caucus come back, and it's like there aren't enough eyeglasses at Hillman and Cohan or whatever the hell that place is to read the various fonts. What is this? Okay. So here's the deal with the Hall of Fame, because I've known about this for a long time, and I have kept the results sealed, hermetically sealed indeed, in a mayonnaise jar on Funkin' Wagnall's porch. Do we have a temp roll or anything, or that would be too much to ask, isn't it? We don't have that? Thank you. All right, so I'm going to do this in chronological order with the oldest person, not by age, but by association with the station first. And so the very first person who we are happy to indicate has been elected to the WCWP Hall of Fame is Muffet Provost.
Yay.
Hey, Muffet.
Now, she is actually a Facebook friend, and I believe she lives in West Virginia. And I have communicated with her back and forth, and she knows, and I know, and I know that she knows that she has been given this honor. But important to note, I have never met her, but I have spoken to Bill Moser about her, and he tells me that although she is short in stature, she was very tall in the enthusiasm department, and that during the height of the Post Pioneers, and we are, that is what we are, the pioneering efforts to get this station on the air, she was there with June Thomas and Larry Brodsky and all these other folks, and Art Beltrone, and I'm sorry?
Hank
Niemark and so on, and actually getting the place with Dr. Costin out of the broom closet and into this radio station. So, and she hopefully will be able to come up here for the award. That's going to be April, I guess. So, congratulations to her. Now, I may be wrong about the dating on this, as to who was first. So what I'm going to do, because I just think it's probably the smart thing to do out of respect, is to go not first with the lady, but first with the reverend. Yes, say a novena, Father, for you have been named John Cummins to the WCWP Hall of Fame.
Hey!
He was raised on a farm in Alabama. No. No. Wait a minute. Someplace I have here. Wait a minute. Jeff Kroll. Here we go. John sent stuff. John stuff. I feel like Ralph Williams. This is your life. Ralph Edwards. If it'll open up. But the fact is, let's just say that John Cummins is an interesting guy in many, many respects, because he started out in radio. And then, where did he end up after that? Working for the phone company. And as you can see, folks, his life went down and down and down. Until finally, get to that in a minute. Here's the deal with what, but seriously, people have to have made some kind of contribution to the radio station here or to the industry or both. And here's the deal. John was a former music and program director here at WCWP, and I'm told that he studied under the baton of Mike Riccio. He also ran the tape library. Now, you could say, well, what's the big deal in running a tape library, except that at the time that he ran the tape library, we were an NPR affiliate, and everything we ran was all tapes all the time. So that was a little more of a substantial job than it might appear. And then, of course, John and I shared microphones at different times at 1240 WGBB, which now, if you can say Shay Shay and Gong Hei Fat Choi, you're a staff announcer. It's all Chinese all the time at 1240 WGBB. How you say Pet Patrol? Anyway. Oh, East WGBB Community Bulletin Board, WGBB, PSBB. Okay, I'm sorry. This is just terrible. Moses, next thing you know, Moses is going to be in that room slamming the plates off, and there isn't even a transmitter in there.
Hey, I'm from the FCC.
Yeah, there you are. There is no FCC. Okay, now, John also worked at WALK Radio and stations in Westchester and Florida as well. And then you worked for what? Was it Verizon or what was it? The phone company? AT&T. So you can understand that after working in the broadcasting industry and then AT&T, you'd feel soiled, you'd feel dirty, you'd feel as though there was no way to cleanse yourself unless you got closer to God. And that's exactly what John did.
Be careful.
He's here now. John went ahead and went back to school. This mic doesn't work, Father. I'm sorry. It's only one confessional, and I've got it.
It's filled with holy water.
Yeah. John went back to school and became an ordained minister. What denomination, seriously?
Anglican.
Okay. An Anglican church, like in England.
Yeah.
Oh. All right. Well, we had a microphone.
No, this one's on?
Oh, it is. Okay. Turn this off for a minute. Tell us about your church affiliation.
Okay. Anglican church, been around for ages, from the Reformation. We are affiliated with the Church of England and bishops, archbishops all throughout the world. The church that I'm leading is in Douglas, Georgia, which is 2 hours north of Jacksonville. So in case you're wondering where, but I was blessed to go to seminary for 3 years and 106 credits.
Wow.
And got my Master's of Divinity. So I'm catching up with you.
So, it's funny. How many credits?
106.
See, I only needed $29 and an email address, and I was ordained. Well, John, in recognition of all of your efforts here at the station and the industry and so on, congratulations and welcome to the WCWP Hall of Fame.
Thank you, Ted. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome, and it's very well deserved. I think there's nobody here who would disagree with me. There's no more decent a soul than John Cummins, and he deserves this.
But he's still alive.
Yes. Now we're going to do posthumous. No, I'm just. All right. And now, the last but not least, Bernie still can't pull up a drum roll. Thank you. She worked for the Voice of America for how long?
21 years.
What was that award you won? You won some fancy award, the Peabody Award or the Edward R. Murrow?
No, when I was back at BAB in the 70s, I won Billboard Magazine's Air Personality of the Year in 1977.
And you can't, right, but you can't come up with a temp roll. All right.
I'm sorry. What can I say?
And last but not least, and I hope Evie Vogel is listening because it's not her. And I hope June Thomas is listening because it's not her. And it's not Judy Herbst. And it's not, who else? Who else? What other? I can't think of any females off the top of my head that worked here, but there is one I can think of.
Me too.
Yes.
Soto.
Who?
It's a recent
Erica Soto. Allie Lied.
Yeah.
None of them.
Nope.
Beverly Bolnick. Nope. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the third and final homecoming weekend Hall of Fame announcement of the following winner. And let me tell you, this person is a champion in every sense of the word. Pat champion Cole.
Yay!
But wait, there's more. She's a 1979 graduate. I feel like I should have that music, the Herb Alpert music from the Dating Game, right? The bum, 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 bum. She's a 1979 graduate from WCWP. She worked here from 75 to 79. She likes cats. She married a guy who's prematurely gray. She managed a record library, produced and directed football broadcasts from 1976 on. She's done 35 plus homecoming games. She coordinated homecoming weekends since 2013. She's co-host of The Rock Show. She's co-head of WCWP Alumni Association since 2013 and actively involved in the station for over 40 years. She proves that you don't have to actually work commercially in the business to have been a devoted alumnus, or in this case, alumna, of the school and the station, and so dedicated, and so I call her the first lady of WCWP, although you and Bernie could probably have a knockdown drag out over that.
No,
I'd pay to see that.
I'll let girl fight.
Wait, with the ghost of Mrs. G refereeing.
We're not going to argue.
The fact is that she is the doyenne of WCWP.
Well, thank you very much.
And so anyway, congratulations to Pat Kroll.
Thank you. Is this thing on? Is it on? Okay.
I hit it harder.
But then it might break, and then I don't know. Thank you so much, everybody. It's just been a wonderful, wonderful, thrilling time for me, and I'm so excited to be in with such esteemed company as those who have come in before me, and the list is quite astonishing, and it's really a treat. And my co-inductee John Cummins and Muffet Provost, I am very, very excited, and I can't wait for the actual induction ceremony. I thank you so very much.
Well, you're very welcome, and I think we've taken up enough time from Bernie's show here. Reverend Dr. Mora, let me just understand one thing now.
Jeez, here we go.
And then I'll leave it alone. I'm a notary public, and the reason I became one, I and another guy at ABC, was so that we could notarize each other's payola forms. Now, so did you become a minister because Cummins is one, and now you can hear each other's confessions?
No, I've been one for 10 years. I went to a seminary.
12.
I got a master's degree at a seminary. Yeah.
Well, you know what? Bless you all.
You too.
And everybody, thanks for tuning in. And back to the homecoming weekend festivities.
Pat, go ahead,
King. Yeah, I just want to congratulate
Chris.
I'd like to congratulate Chris MacIntosh on the very, very first WCWP Lifetime Achievement Award, and I think that's just phenomenal. And there's no better recipient to be the very first, and your name will carry on for many years.
All right. Thank you all. Congratulations, everybody, and we are celebrating at WCWP. Eighty-eight point one FM and WCWP.org. Dusty Springfield and the Pet Shop Boys, and what have I done to deserve that? Deserve this? That's for my friend Padre Michael, who's listening out in Albuquerque, New Mexico, at the Balloon Festival. Right before we heard Dexy's Midnight Runners, Come On Eileen, and Ed Sheeran and Galway Girl here on WCWP. Okay, we've had a few calls. There's one more person I want to talk to. One of our alumni, Fran Fried. Are you there, Fran?
I hope so.
Oh, good. Now, two things. First of all, we have a radio show on internet radio. Tell me about Franorama.
Oh, yeah, I do a show. I live up in Connecticut. It's Cygnus Radio. It's an online station based in Connecticut. It's a mighty little online station that could. And I host a show every other week called Franorama 2.0. It's on every other Thursday, 1 to 4 Eastern.
Now,
Musically, I just throw everything against the wall and see what sticks, and thankfully we're unencumbered by FTC regulations.
Oh, good. Yeah, you have a pretty good playlist. I've seen some of them. Now, the big news is one of our WCWP alumni, Fran, is going to be on Jeopardy Tuesday. I know there's not a lot you can reveal, but how did that happen, and can you tell us how you did it all?
Well, I fell somewhere on the spectrum between Ken Jennings and Cliff Clavin.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So Austin's gone, and that other woman, Scarlett, what was her name? She was scary smart.
Oh, you know what? I was there. That was all taped the first week of August. They were shot on the Wednesday, and I was shot on Thursday. They shoot five shows a day every other Wednesday and Thursday. And so I was there to watch Austin's last four games. I had not seen his act. I had not seen his act up close and personal. But yeah, he was kind of goofy. But you know, he didn't scare me really. I mean, part of me wanted to go up against him, part of me didn't. But Scarlett scared the living hell out of me. She was because we during the rehearsals, you know, they jump you around from podium to podium to get sound levels and camera angles and all that neat stuff. And Scarlett was playing right next to me for like a few questions, and she just kept beating me to the buzzer by like a razor.
Oh, wow.
You know?
Well, can you tell us anything at all about how you did? I mean, any kind of clue? Should we ask?
Well,
are you happy?
Well, I'll be happier if I can get a full time job, but that's beside the point.
That's with a lot of us.
Basically, I can tell you that it will be epic television.
Wow.
It makes for great television, that's for darn sure.
So it's Tuesday the 17th, I believe?
Yep.
Tuesday the 17th?
Tuesday the 17th. Check times and listings in your area.
Okay.
And, I'm just hoping that being on the show opens some doors. I mean, it's been crazy the last week. I put up one photo of me and my close personal friend, Trebek, back on Monday, and like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people liked it and shared it, and that's like, holy cow. And
We are almost out of time. I'm sorry, I got to cut you short.
Okay, sure.
Tuesday night, Fran Fried, one of our alumni, is going to be on Jeopardy. Thank you so much for calling. I appreciate it.
Hey, Bernie, thanks for having me. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay, bye-bye. All right, that's one of our alumni, Fran Fried. Watch for her on Jeopardy. Now, we have a couple of minutes here. What is happening? Bobby G and Mike Riccio are here. You guys are coming up next. How about a clue as to what we're going to hear?
We're coming up next. Wait, aren't Alan you? Alan is in here.
Alan, who's coming up next? Who's this?
He's doing the Graveyard.
No, wait a minute now. Hold on a minute.
I'm going home now.
Don't confuse me. I'm easily confused.
Well, let's see.
I'm actually pre-recorded tonight.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm on tape.
Oh, okay.
So let's see. Hi, Bobby.
Hi, how you doing, Mike?
Okay. So originally, Bernie, what we had planned to do was a tribute to one-hit wonders from each year. But, you know, Bobby visits up on my show quite often, and Bobby is used to my countdowns and my Archies and my Tommy Rose and all that. And I think, you know what? I really got to give Bobby a break tonight and some things that he could relate to. So I dug deep and I came up with the list of the best lobotomy songs. Right, Alan, very good. I said not you know, I said that from Alan, not from me.
Lobotomy songs.
Anyway, we are going to do the top LP cuts from the 60s. All the stuff I never played in.
Oh, that's great. Fantastic. Good
and then
time.
Bobby only played, and you only played.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
That should be
so
fun.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anyhow, so we have that coming up in like a minute. Well, I don't know. I guess I can put... We're kind of running over a little bit. I'm sorry, guys.
Don't worry about it.
Tell you what. I'm going to play the instrumental version of Lola.
Okay.
And you can kind of fade it down whenever you want.
All
but
right.
Bobby G, Mike Riccio coming up. And, oh, just a reminder about the homecoming football game. Post Pioneers 52, Southern Connecticut Owls 35.
Wow.
So, pretty good game. Anyhow, thanks, everybody. This show always goes so fast. Oh, my gosh. Another homecoming in the history books, at least for me. I'll see you next year. Here are the Kinks on WCWP.
And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Yes, am I here? Do you hear me?
Hi, Mike.
Is that my name? Okay, yeah. Mike
hello.
Riccio and Bobby G on Homecoming week.
How we doing?
1972. Oh, no, wait, I lost track of the years, Bob. Is it really that long? I don't know.
Mike, this is my 50th year at the station.
Wow. Are they at least bringing you lunch and dinner while you're here? Does somebody bring you food?
The helicopter just landed before.
Do you ever get out of this place? I don't know.
I have a true story for you. Last time I was here, the Secret Service was here.
Oh, really?
I kid you not. Bill Clinton was on campus and gave a speech.
It really was secret.
And literally within 100 feet or so of the station, the cars were literally outside the door.
Really?
Yeah. And this is in the Post Pioneer newspaper.
When was this?
This was a week ago Thursday. Yeah. I felt very important.
Did they pat you down and
No, let me walk right by.
Well, we are celebrating.
He was speaking at the time.
We are celebrating a homecoming. See how we just segged right out of Bill Clinton.
That's right. No problem.
Celebrating homecoming. We were on last year at night, right? And the year before, we were on Saturday morning. We've been all over the place here.
We did a Saturday morning a good 4 years ago now. We did the
really?
Last 3 years.
That wasn't as bad as I thought. I just came in and slept in from the night before, and I was okay. But
we did that before the football game 1 year, which was fun.
Yeah.
I was very impressed how you went back and talked to the press people on your controls and everything. You're quite an engineer.
Well, you know what? You do what you got to do.
That's right.
What can I tell you? But as we bore everyone to tears here.
That's our job.
But it's good to celebrate and come up here once a year for the homecoming weekend, which is really nice. And, of course, you and I are fortunate enough to have our shows that we do during the week every month or so. And I usually do a countdown of some sort, as you know, because you visit me often. As I was saying, you're used to me doing the mostly top 40 and pop countdowns, correct,
right,
Bobby?
Exactly.
And you sit there and you tolerate and smile as I play the Archies and Tommy Rowe and
you exaggerate, and
the Cufflinks. So I figured I'd reward you tonight, and we would play the biggest album cuts of the 1960s from Best Albums. That's the name of the site. And they are some heavy duty album rankers and raiders. And they check the sales, and they check popularity, and they come up with this list of album cuts. And what's interesting is some of these are purely album versions of singles. Some are actually singles from the albums.
Right.
They relate to them as that, and others are just strictly album cuts. So that's what we are doing tonight. And we started things off with a little help from my friends. I figure that's what we're doing, Bob, right? With a little help of all our WCWP friends here, 88.1 FM. And WCWP.org. That's
O-R-G.
Right. I thought I'd trick you into saying com, but not.
No, we
not
used
so.
To be .com way back in the day, but not anymore.
That's right. So we. That's right. So we did the Sgt. Pepper's. Are you surprised, Bob, that came in number 78 out of the top 100?
A little bit, but there are some really big songs that I know came out in the 60s, so I'm not that totally surprised.
Yeah, okay. I really figured it would come in much higher than that. Then we had. Actually, it was a big hit on it. You recognize that as a single of the Kinks.
Right.
You Really Got Me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that came in at number 82. Of course, a much bigger hit than that when it was actually out.
Right.
As you remember. And then we had Johnny Cash. And you said, although you never played that as an album cut, that really strictly was more of an album cut than a single hit. And it was really from the early 60s. He actually recorded that even in the 50s.
Really?
And by the time it made the list, that's where it ranked. It came out on one of his 1960s albums. So it was kind of interesting. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to play a lot of random selections.
Good.
I'm going to hand you the official list, and you're going to actually pick some of your favorites.
Good enough.
So how about that? Huh?
That's nice.
All right. And I'll leave in about 5 minutes. I'll be back in 2 hours. Let me know how the show went. And the last hour, we'll actually play the top 10, right?
Good.
So how about, I hear what number 98 is, almost at the very bottom of the list.
Top 100?
Are you ready?
All right.
See if you can identify this. Right. Here we go.
Number 98!
Pinball Wizard.
That's right.
Oh, do you remember when we got this? They gave us a packet of singles that they wanted us to play from the album because they wanted to decide at the record company what would actually possibly sell as a single.
That's right. I remember now that you mentioned it. Little 45 packet.
This was one of the biggest hits, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Could I have a little guitar twang come, please, now? Thank you. One more, please. Now I'm ready to rock and roll. Bobby G with you with Mike Riccio.
Ever since I was a young boy, I played the silver ball. From Soho down to Brighton, I must
just to play them all.
Yeah.
Hi. How you doing, Mike? Yeah. I said, tell me what I'm going to talk. And you said, how about right now?
How about right now? Why
that's,
not?
That's tight radio. That's good old FM.
That's right. Because when we have our rock show shows. All right. Do you know when we take the breaks? Usually at 11 and 22 minutes after the hour. And what is it now?
There's no format tonight.
That's right. So that's why
that's because John Cummings is here and he doesn't know that he has a format.
That's
but we have decided just for ourselves that there's no format. But we might even let him read the weather, I was told.
That's right.
If he's a good boy.
So what are we doing here tonight, Bobby G? What are we playing?
Album tracks. Because
What kind of album tracks?
I'm finally getting equal time here. The big ones, the ones that sold. The ones that were very popular.
From
on
what
FM.
Decade, Bobby?
From the 60s.
Okay.
Am I doing so well?
Yeah, Bobby is doing great.
I'm wound up.
Yes, you finally get a choice of music tonight, but remember, I can cut off your microphone at any time.
That's all right. It's okay.
So what are your memories of taking a load off?
Annie. I took a load off Annie.
With the
with Quinn the Eskimo, with the, you know,
that although that was not a single 45 hit,
no,
that's one of the songs that reminds me most of the radio station here back then.
I used to play Chess Fever from that album. That was the one I played.
Yeah, and I think that the weight was eventually a 45 that they released, but I would imagine you played that.
I probably did play that
through the years.
It wasn't
right?
my favorite on the album, but it was one of the good tracks.
Mm-hmm. And then Pinball Wizard, which of course you brought back some. I'd forgotten all about that. That they sent out a little package with the 45s. Of the tracks on the album, so they can get a feel from the college stations which ones were would be the most popular and best ones to release, because they did back then poll a lot of the stations. I know that I used to get calls from them too, and when I made my call out for the research here, and they actually they wanted our opinion, Bobby. Do you believe that? I felt so wanted.
And when we were off air, I mentioned the group Chicago. When the first album came out, we were playing tracks from that, and when the second album came out, they had singles from it, but they went back to the first album for some of the stuff that had gotten a lot of airplay in college.
Wow. Okay.
So the stuff on the second album actually as singles came out before the stuff that was on the original Chicago Transit Authority album.
Very interesting. And then they, of course, took off in the 70s.
Right.
And they actually developed, they had the, I believe, the same producer that did the Buckingham stuff.
Yes.
And he sort of switched over to Chicago. It was interesting because I remember actually speaking to one of the members of the Buckinghams at one of these record shows way back when. And remember that song, Susan?
Yes.
Where they put that psychedelic part
piece in it?
And the band actually hated that. They could not stand that section. But Riccio, Riccio put that in there. They didn't even know about it. They just said, oh, we're going to put it in. And then so they just put it in there.
It was attention getting.
Yeah.
And it was helping them garner a progressive audience in its own subtle, sneaky way, is my opinion. I could be wrong.
Yeah, because if you remember, what else was happening? The year that came out was 1967, Susan?
Yes, and they had
I believe
the
67, 68.
Well, that wild stuff.
That's right, with the psychedelic stuff. Yeah, with all that psychedelic stuff, you're right. So that's
so
what
they had to borrow it.
That's the very reason that they ended up doing that. So so anyway, we're gonna play some more of the songs. We're playing sort of the lower regions of the numbers now, and then we get into the top 10 in the last hour. But we'll see if you know this one. Now this guy was all over these charts. I actually do a countdown here of just the songs that made it from him. But I bet you must have had at least 10 songs that made it, along with of course a lot of Beatles stuff and everything else. But we'll see how long it takes you to recognize
number
this.
49.
Bob.
Got it.
John is in a basement mixing up the medicine. I'm on the pavement thinking about the government.
Please, please help me. Help me. Help me.
Help. Help. Help me, Bobby. Help. Help me make it through this night, Bobby.
We have a doctor in the house now.
Okay.
Did you hear that Bernie's a doctor now?
Bernie Bernard is a doctor?
Yes, she is. And we have some people in here that need a checkup from the neck up, so she'll come in very handy.
There are people here who are permanently sick. So
a doctor of theology is...
Well, we're at WCWP, and we are celebrating the homecoming weekend here of this radio station. The station started when, Bob? 1961?
61.
On campus? And FM started in 65, right?
March 16th, 1961.
Right.
And the FM October 18th, 1965.
That's a famous date in history, isn't it, Bob?
Well, it's my birthday. It's kind of...
There you go. There you go. So we're playing tonight the biggest album cuts of all time, and that was the Beatles, of course. But what was different about that one, Bob? What made it an album cut?
Well, that beginning that you played, of course.
Right.
And... Mike, I lost my train of thought for something, but I'm really sorry.
That's all right. We have a doctor here. Okay. This is no problem. We'll call Bernie in. to help you out. The interesting thing that the album cut very slight difference on some of the intonation on John's vocal on Help, where it sounds just slightly different than the single. And then what did we do before that? We had Jefferson.
Blackbird. Oh, we had Blackbird also.
Blackbird, all right. Again, a little
different version.
So tonight with these... cuts that we're playing, some are exactly the LP cuts, right, some are the single cuts, some are slight variations, different takes. We're all over the map with this, but some interesting stuff. And Jefferson Airplane, too, with Somebody to Love. They were big in the era.
Grace Slick had another band before Jefferson Airplane called The Great Society, and she brought that song over with her to the Jefferson Airplane. That was the second album, not the first.
And they also had a different female vocalist for a while, didn't they?
Right.
Before she came on.
That's right.
All right. So that's what we had. That's what we had there, and that's what we're going to be doing tonight. And in the last hour, playing the top 10 LP cuts. But Michael, we have a special guest here.
Mike Chimeri is
Mike Chimeri.
Yeah, and he is taking photographs of us. It used to be
and video.
So we used to just get embarrassed with WCWP, but now people in China, Russia, they all can look at us and laugh and say, "What are these clowns doing?"
It's not just the audio evidence. Now we have video evidence.
Right.
So, Michael, what are your memories of the station? Now, you did basically a jazz-oriented show, didn't you?
I did.
Okay.
And while I was a student, and even for a couple of years as an alumnus, I was called the Mike Chimeri Show before you had to have the name of the format of the name of the genre. The jazz show with Mike Chimeri. I called it the Mike Chimeri Show back then. But it was contemporary jazz, it was new age, it was fusion. And I enjoyed it very much. And Jay Mirabile, my first semester that I was at WCWP, it was my third year here, Jay was on before me.
And
that's all there is to the story.
He played
disco and
disco
funk
and jazz.
I'm waiting for a punchline over here.
there's nothing there. It's just a simple anecdote.
We haven't gotten rid of Jay yet either. That's the deal.
That's okay.
Jay was here earlier today. Yeah. And of course, he had a show last night.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that personally, jazz is having a very strong rebirth right now. It's popping up all over the place. It's having a whole new wide acceptance. Everything from the pop jazz to the real heavy duty kind of jazz. As a matter of fact, in doing the top list from the 50s, originally I was going to have some cuts from the LP tracks from the 50s, dominated by jazz.
Right.
Dominated by jazz. Like names that...
Take Five by Dave Brubeck Quartet.
Dave Brubeck. That was the number two LP cut. I think number one was a Charles, how do you pronounce it? Mingus. He had about five or six on the list in the top 20. Just unbelievable. But I figured we'd turn it into the Michael Jazz Show if we did that tonight. So I said, no, I think we have to skip the 1950s and go with the 60s, which was the era that Bobby G helped to shape.
With Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass. That was their decade.
So Bobby and I decided we're going to play a song just because you had that jazz show. A little bit of a clue here. Maybe you can get it from the clues. But what happened, this turned into an unexpected hit in 1964. Now, the hit was an edited version of it with a female vocalist. The long version of it was on the album originally, and what happened was that they were in the studio and just at the last minute they decided that they would get a female vocalist. They needed somebody for a middle chorus that they felt would sound sort of sweet and innocent to do the middle chorus of this. So the vocalist called over and got his new young bride, just barely in her 20s at the time, and they decided let's give her the middle chorus just to jazz it up a little bit, change it up a little bit. And as it turned out, it came out so great that they edited out for the single all the male vocals in it, and they just kept her part in it. And that's the part that Bob and I actually like the single better. The only reason I have this here, which is about 5 minutes, is because this is the actual original album cut before they edited it. Do you have any idea? 1964 is when it, don't give it away now, Bob. Look at him.
No, I love when he does this to me because I always get it wrong.
That's right. Like,
there's no pressure.
I have no idea.
I chased him away. That's the reason why. He doesn't come up as much anymore. He knows. Okay. I put
bright
him
in to the studio and the pressure. Sure, oh, killing me.
No, yeah. I think you'll. Should we you'll play know. It? Should we Wait, play for Michael? Right about right now. Oh, okay, here we go.
Number 62.
Number 62. Here we go. Why? It's the girl from Ipanema.
Olha que coisa mais linda, mais cheia de graça. Ela, menina que vem, que passa.